Hello and welcome to Wright's Chapel. My name is Tiny and I'm the Director of Connection Ministries. Thank you for worshiping with us today. We're hoping you'll let us know of your attendance by typing in your name and the name of those worshiping with you in the comments section. This is also a great opportunity to greet one another and to say hello to those who may be new to online worship. If you have questions about Wright's Chapel or you'd like to learn more about its ministries, feel free to reach out to me directly at tanya@wrightschapel.org. Again, thanks so much for worshiping with us, and may God bless you as Clay leads us into a song of praise.
I'm Clay Motley, the music director at Wright's Chapel, and I'm inviting you to join us in singing out loud these next few songs we're going to do. So whoever you got with you, watch the words on the screen, sing it as loud as you can, dance if you want to dance, engage with us, have fun with us, and let's do some songs together.
Welcome to Wright's Chapel. It is so good to be in worship with you this day. Whenever it is that you are worshiping with us, we thank you for making time to worship our God together with us. My name is Charles. I'm pastor here at Wright's Chapel. Thank you again for joining us for worship. If you haven't already, we want to invite you to check in to let us know that you're worshiping with us. You can do so by typing your name, the name of any of those who are in the room with you, into the comment section. Or we recognize if you're on YouTube, it may be easier for you to simply text Tanya at 540-604-0038. It is so helpful for us to know who it is that is worshiping with us. At the end of the service, we hope that if this service is meaningful to you, enjoyable, that you'll press the share button and that you'll help us share the gospel with your friends and your connections as well. And also, if you're ever in the area, we hope that that you'll stop in, that we can meet face to face. Sometimes we know we got folks who live in our community and are worshiping with us online, and would love to have you stop in during the week, even if you can't come on a Sunday morning. Or if you're just passing through, if you're outside our area and passing through, please stop by. We'd love to make that face to face connection. Well, I want to give a shout out to Morgan Smith, who's been worshiping with us online. So good to have her as a part of our worshiping community. Just a couple of announcements that next Saturday, if you are in our area, we are having a new thing that we're doing called Plants, Pots, and Things. And one of our members, a little more, has put this together for those who are plant enthusiasts. And they're going to have an opportunity to learn about plants and potting plants and putting plants outdoors and all kinds of things about plants, to purchase plants. We are also having a bake sale along with that. And so if you're able in our area and could bake something for our bake sale, we certainly would appreciate that effort. And you can drop that by the church anytime this week. That Plants, Pots, and Things next week, starting at 9. On April 28th, that's next Sunday, at 11 o'clock, we will be having a charge conference. That's an official meeting of our church as we seek to find approvals for the new building that we're ready to construct for our thrift store and our mobile ministry. And so if you're in the area, we'd love to have you join us at 11 o'clock for that charge conference. As we continue in our worship time, we want to invite you, if you have any prayer requests, to share those with us. You can type those into the comment section or you can text those to Tanya. We will have a team of folks that want to be in prayer and in ministry with you. And so let us then prepare to go to God in prayer.
Hi, my name is Lana. Let us pray. Oh God, you call us to spirit of unity with one another. You urge us to end the divisions among us. We often wonder, how is this even possible? With fists clenched and jaws set, we grip tightly to our perspectives and opinions, ready for battle. So often we worship the God of being right, and so our quarrels reach our ears. And even as we stammer out our excuses, we know it is not your way. We know your way is a better way. Your way is relationship, disciplineship, neighborliness, servanthood. Help us to imagine your way as we bow before you this day. Help us to imagine sitting down together and breaking bread. Show us, God, how to drop our nets which we clutch to ourselves. Teach us rather to share and make us into your fishers of people. Or perhaps we must simply allow ourselves to be caught by you first. Hear our prayers for all of those who are sick and in distress. May your grace and your love reach out in ways that will bring healing and hope to those whose lives are in turmoil. We pray these in our prayers in the name of Jesus, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and power and the glory forever. Amen.
Carson, and today we'll be reading Hebrews 1 through 1:3. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days he has spoken to us by a son, whom he appointed heir of all things, Though womb, he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being.
I want to thank all those who have helped lead us in our time of worship this morning. Let us pray together. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts truly be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Let me start with this question. Any of y'all have someone in your life that you really appreciate? You really appreciate them, but you don't particularly care to see. You're so thankful for them, but at times you may even try to avoid them. And some of you heard that question and immediately you thought of a crazy aunt or an uncle, because we've all got the crazy relative, right? If you're sitting there and you can't think of the crazy relative in your family, guess what? Somebody is probably thinking of you. Some of you heard that question and thought, is there someone I appreciate but often try and avoid? And well, yeah, he's sitting right next to me, and I just want to invite you, don't put your hands down. We'll be doing a group marriage counseling after worship in my office if you need that. My question, though, was referring more to categories of people and not particular individuals. So I was thinking like funeral directors, right, are a group of folks. We appreciate them, so glad that they are there when we need them, but we don't particularly care to have to see them. Although better to see them than to be seen by them. Lawyers are maybe another category. We don't want to have to see a lawyer, but we appreciate them when we need them. Insurance adjusters, right? The septic guy. Can you think of another group of folks that you appreciate, right, but you try to avoid? Go ahead and comment in the section. What are the groups that you think of in those categories? In my life, I include doctors in my life in that group. I appreciate doctors. I am so thankful for doctors. I don't care to have to go see them. Some doctors more so than others. No one wants to see the colonoscopy doctor, right? A dentist, right? That's never a pleasant thought. I appreciate what they do, but I'm not bubbling with anticipation to go see my dentist. Now, the one doctor that I got to tell you that I kind of enjoy going to, at least at this point in my life, is the optometrist. I had an appointment not too long ago with my eye doctor, just a checkup appointment. And when I got there, the nurse, she was very polite, didn't even make me step on the scale. I love that place, right? The chair at the eye doctor, that was pretty comfortable. And then they bring that big machine up to your face, and they have you look through and read the letters, and they will start flipping different lenses in front of your eyes. Mr. Tillipaw, can you tell us which one is clear, one or two? Now two or three? Now again, is it one or two? And it's always amazing to me the crystal clarity that the correct lens can make things appear. It's just so cool, all right? And sometimes, I don't know if this ever happened to you, sometimes I never realized how blurry things were in my life until I had the right lens in front of me. And I bring all this up because we are starting a new worship series today called Coming Into Focus. Scripture, tradition, reason, experience. And isn't one of the things that we all want as Christians is to see and to understand God more clearly? Don't we often come to worship seeking clarity, clear direction from God for our lives? We want to see and understand God clearly. The thought being that if we could only see God's will clearly, it would be easier to follow God's path and to make those sometimes tough decisions. And go ahead, just name the category in your life, whether it's work, finances, health, relationships with our spouse, with our children, relationships that have gone at times south on us, right? We often seek clarity and what it is that God would want us to do. I often have people say to me, Pastor, I've got this decision to make. Can you pray for me? Can you help me discern God's will for my life? I'm not sure what is the right thing to do. What would God want me to do in this situation? Can you help me to see where God is leading me? And what all those questions are asking for is clarity. We want a clear picture. Because sometimes our understanding of God and God's desire for our lives, it can feel blurry, totally out of focus. And as Christians, we want our faith in God to help inform our lives. But in certain situations, we can feel so confused. And it's hard to know what to do because the picture we see of God and God's desires, it's still blurry. We don't know a whole lot about the author of the New Testament book of Hebrews. We do know that he was a teacher of sorts and that he was writing to a small group of Christians in the city of Rome. And the writer of the book of Hebrews begins by telling us that long ago God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. And what the author is referencing is the Old Testament. And he's saying that God, way back then, gave us a whole bunch of access points in order to recognize God. Sometimes God would reveal himself through things like a burning bush, right? Or through the separation of waters and the parting of the Red Sea, or some other extravagant miracle. In the Old Testament, God sometimes revealed God's self through words that were written down, like when Moses ascended and then descended Mount Sinai, and Moses came down with two tablets of what we call the Ten Commandments. We believe that God would reveal God's self through the law of the Levitical code and through the words of the prophets. And there were other ways that God would be revealed. When we come to the New Testament, We, like the writer of Hebrews, believe that in Jesus Christ we see God. If we want to know what God is like, if we want a picture of God and what God would want for us, then we should look at Jesus. Jesus is the best picture we have of God. That's why we have those bracelets, right, that say WWJD. What would Jesus do? But for many of us as Christians today who can only read about Jesus in Scripture, we face times when life can feel so complicated. And sometimes we read Scripture and we pray to Jesus and no answer seems to come. And so we live with an uncertainty and we wonder, what would God have me to do? And in the face of that uncertainty, we believe that there are four primary lenses that help us to see and understand God and to understand God's desire for our lives. Lenses that help us get to the most clarity. And they are Scripture, tradition, reason, and experience. And I want to talk about each of these four categories as we pursue a clear understanding of God, knowing that if we only look through one lens, sometimes our picture of God may feel incomplete. Most of us understand that Scripture, right, the Bible, is the primary, the main lens through which we get a picture of God and God's desire for us. It's in Scripture that we read about Jesus. We see in Jesus that we read about a God of love and grace and justice and mercy. And so some folks ask, well, what's the problem? Just ask, what would Jesus do? It's so simple, right? But come on now. You've tried just reading the Scripture. I've tried. And the picture can still be blurry. They told you to read the Bible, and you read it, but you got frustrated with the Bible and with God. And even Jesus at times in the Bible didn't make a lot of sense. And, And the Bible had some weird stories in it, and you were left confused, and you had lots of questions. And some of you who are highly cerebral, you read about some of those miracles of Jesus, and yeah, you got some questions. And you read the scriptures, and in your mind, some of those scriptures seem to be affirming an economic system that involves slavery. But this book, you were told, is the word of God. And so you're like, wait a minute, hold on. That doesn't seem to make sense. And so you had some more questions. And sometimes, I suspect for some of us, they were questions that no one seemed to want to tackle. And it was obvious that some of your questions struck an uncomfortable nerve with some of the folks in charge of the religious circles you were involved in. And so you were told just to stop asking so many questions. And you know the line, the Bible says it, we believe it, that settles it. So you were quiet. But the questions, they were still there. And some of you may have grown up in a highly traditional church, and in your church you didn't seem like you paid that much attention to the Bible. The priest took care of that for you, and you just did the traditions, and you repeated the words they told you to say, and you went through the motions that you were told to do, and at times you left out of there thinking, I don't feel very clear about God. Or maybe you grew up in a highly experiential church, and the leaders of that church, they focused a lot on the Holy Spirit and miracles and in the speaking of tongues. And at times it felt strange, but it was also really powerful. But still maybe a bit incomplete, and you wanted to read the scripture more. The point is that each of those four lenses is a valid lens. And yet it is when we bring all four lenses together that the clearest picture of God emerges. Actually, the founder of the Methodist Church, John Wesley, helped to develop this approach to understanding God more clearly. John Wesley lived in the middle of the 1700s. He was an Anglican priest and a student at Oxford University. Thus, Wesley, he was well scripted in scripture. He was steeped in the traditions of the church. But John Wesley, he also loved the foot stomping music that brought spirit into the room. Wesley loved the possibility that God intervenes in the supernatural and in the speaking of tongues. And while at the same time he was a student at Oxford, which at that time was the epicenter of intellectual pursuits, and Wesley would sit around with the greatest intellectual minds of his day and argue and debate the nature of God. And it was through all these interactions that Wesley over time began to understand that it is not just about one lens, but all four lenses working together in tension that gives us the clearest picture of God and God's desire for our lives. One time, John Wesley, he was on a boat sailing to a new colony called Georgia. And he was planning to launch a new ministry there with Native Americans. But then in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, they ran into a massive hurricane. And the boat was about to capsize and sink. And Wesley went into a full-on panic attack. He's all worked up. And he looks over there. And to his left, there was another group of Christians on the same boat called Moravians. And Wesley's over cowering in the corner, sweating, and they're over there singing happy songs. They got a guitar out singing Kumbaya, all while the ship is going down. And they don't appear to be worried at all. They were so confident in their faith that even if the ship went under, that they were sure that they were going to a better place. And Wesley is in the corner panicking, and he starts asking, how can this be when we worship the same God? How can they be so confident in God? And he had no confidence at all. And it was from that experience that Wesley began to process this dance before these four lenses which we use to see God. And what Wesley discovered is that it's actually how these four lenses work in tension with one another that gives us our clearest picture of God and God's desire for our lives. Now, certainly, the Bible, the Holy Scriptures, is our highest authority. But at times, Scripture lives in tension, right, with the intellect. And what that means is that we read the Bible using our brains. And in our reading of Scripture, there are often going to be questions that arise. And what Wesley is saying is that we are allowed to challenge and question the Bible. We should question the cultural assumptions of the biblical writers. And when we ask questions and when we seek answers, oftentimes a clearer picture of God and God's desires emerge. And yes, Wesley would say, traditions are essential and they're vital. And that is why we baptize, and it's why we share in communion. It's why we say the Lord's Prayer each week. It's why we state the creeds. But we also know that if we simply do all those traditions without Scripture or without intellect, that will feel incomplete too. And yes, God absolutely speaks to us through the supernatural and through the miraculous and through the Spirit. And we feel the presence of God. We feel it in here. We feel it in our hearts. But we don't have a formula for that. And we can't bottle that up. And yet when we allow all of these lenses to live in tension with one another, what Wesley found is there's actually more spiritual progress that is made. The preacher Andy Stanley, he has said that there are some problems in the world that we as Christians shouldn't seek to solve. There are some problems in the world that we as Christians should seek to solve. And then he says there are some problems in our world that we don't need to solve. And I'll tell you, for those among us who are problem solvers, for those of us who are doers, right, that can be a problem. Because for many of us, tension, right, is a bad word. I don't know about you, but a lot of us, we don't like tension. We want to solve the tension. In my household, I'm a peacemaker. I hate for there to be tension. I hate for there to be conflict in our house. If my wife is mad at me about something, I want to figure out how to make her unmad. I want to get rid of the tension. But sometimes there are tensions that don't need to be resolved. And you all know this, right? Because at your workplace, you've got the finance department, and they are the hawks of the organization. And they want to know where every penny is being spent. And they are counting the sheets of toilet paper. And they're the ones sending out a memo at the end of the month stating that each employee now is only allowed 8 sheets per day. And on the other end of the building, you have the creative department, and they have all these elaborate plans and creative ideas of how to grow. But those creative ideas, of course, cost money. And there's tension. And you sit in the middle office, and you know that for you all as a company to be at your best, you need both departments. And you know that tension needs to exist. And so you don't solve the tension one way or the other, but you try and manage the tension, right? You manage the tension for the best possible outcomes. Some of you experience this in your own home. And there is tension, right? Because you're trying to honor all of your responsibilities at work. But then you also want to honor all of your responsibilities at home. And it's hard to do both, isn't it? Moms and dads, can I get an amen, right? There's tension. And maybe it's a tension that you feel inside of you when you're pulled in both directions. Maybe it creates tension with your spouse, with your children. But if you try and simply solve the tension one side or the other, you still got tension. I mean, think about it. If you just said, I'm just going to be at home all the time, I'm not going to go to work anymore, that will create some other tensions come payday. But if all you do is throw yourself into your work and you're never available at home or never available for kids, never go to their games, yeah, there's still going to be tension. And so we don't ever fully resolve the tension. What we learn is how to manage the tension. And when we learn to manage that, the beauty and the clarity emerges as the tension is well managed. And John Wesley believed that this is true about the nature of our faith. And Wesley recognized how local churches often tried to hold fast and exclusively to one of the four lenses, either scripture, tradition, reason, or experience, at the expense of the other three. And what he recognizes is that when that happens, people's picture and understanding of God's and God's desire always seems to be a little bit more blurry. And so John Wesley started living differently. And he started acknowledging the value of all four lenses, scripture, tradition, reason, experience, and how clarity and progress was made in seeing and understanding God, not when the tension of the four lenses was resolved, but when it was lived in together. And what John Wesley discovered, that it was not about getting the right balance between the four lenses, but seeing and understanding God clearly is about getting into the right rhythm. Sometimes in seeking to resolve the tension, we think the solution is to having a balanced approach, right? Can I tell you, experiencing God, seeing God, understanding God clearly, it is not about balance. It's about rhythm. And this is what I mean. Whenever we start to put together a worship service where we're hoping to experience God, can I tell you there's always tension? We're planning a big service like Easter or Christmas. And the band always says, well, we need more time. There are more songs we want to sing because that is where God really is revealed, and we want to sing more. And I'll tell you, as a preacher, I love the music, right? But I'm saying, hey, wait a minute. I need to be able to talk longer. I need to be able to talk as long as the Spirit provides me something to say. And so there's this tension. And then there's the nursery workers and the Sunday school teachers, and they're saying, we don't care about the music. We don't care about the preaching. For God's sakes, just let us out on time, right? That tendency when making a plan is to say, okay, let's get good balance. And so music, you get 15 minutes, and there's 15 minutes for prayer and scripture reading and communion, and 15 minutes for the preacher and 15 minutes for announcements, because we want a good balance. But I'm telling you, that doesn't work either. Because experiencing God and seeing God clearly isn't about balance. It's about a rhythm. Seeing God and experiencing God is about knowing how to dance. And sometimes the truth is we need more music. We need more singing. And sometimes we need more preaching. And sometimes we need more prayer. And in the dance to experience God, we don't seek balance. We seek to be in rhythm with God. If when in our dancing we allow the tension not to be resolved, it's amazing the clarity that can occur. So today, friends, this is my intro, and I realize that there's not a lot of resolution in today's message, and that I didn't use a lot of scripture, but that was by design. Because next week we're going to come back, and we're going to talk about scripture. And then we'll talk about tradition, and then we'll talk about reason, and we'll talk about experience, And I hope this series, Coming Into Focus, Scripture, Tradition, Reason, Experience, I hope it's going to be fun. But I really hope that it will arm us with the lenses we need so that when we look for God and we look for God's desire in our lives, maybe we'll have a clearer picture. And so I hope you'll plan to come back next week. And we're going to talk about seeing God through the lens of Scripture. And we're going to talk about what it means when we say, the Bible says, peace and amen. Again, let me just say thank you for the gifts you give to Life Our Church that just allow us to do so much ministry in the name of Christ. And I want to thank a whole group of folks who came out yesterday and helped us clean up the roadways here in front of our church all the way down to Madison Elementary, and for Travis who helped to get us organized and that we could be in mission and ministry for our community, for our church, but also for our community in the name of God. And I'm thankful for all the ways in which this church reaches out into the community and seeks to make this a better place. But we can't do that without the gifts that you give. And so we're appreciative and thankful for the gifts that you give to the life of our church that just allow us to do so many things in the name of Christ. For the gifts that you text in, that you mail in, that you send in online, they matter, and we appreciate them. Thank you. And now receive this benediction, and then Clay will lead us into a song of praise, that we may go forth into this world in peace and be of good courage. Hold fast to what is good and render to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted and support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor every person. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the powers of the Holy Spirit. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts, our minds in Christ Jesus, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Bow down and hail you out.